In Joshua, the 14th chapter, you know, there's an amazing testimony here, followed by a heart cry for not an easy place, but a tough place. Joshua 14 chapter, please. From the 9th verse. And Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land whereon your feet have trodden shall be your inheritance, and your children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord my God. And now, behold, the Lord has kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word unto Moses, while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness. And now, lo, I am this day 85 years old, and yet I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, even so is my strength now, for war, both to go out and to come in. Now therefore, give me this mountain, whereof the Lord spake in that day. For thou heardest in that day how the Anakims, the giants, were there, and that the cities were great and fenced. If so be the Lord will be with me, then I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said. And Joshua blessed him, and gave unto Caleb, the son of Jephunne, Hebron, for an inheritance. Now, my dear friends, our natural inclination is to go and ask for something nice and easy, isn't it? It's a big temptation. My father used to speak about guidance. On one occasion, he said, somebody gifted him or sent him a packet with 2 lovely handkerchiefs. One a silken handkerchief and the other more an ordinary type of handkerchief. And my father decided he did not need 2 of them, he would rather give one away to some friend. So he went and said to the Lord, Lord, which of these 2 handkerchiefs should I give? And the Lord told him, give away that beautiful silken handkerchief. You know, my father said, well, the Lord told me, therefore I gave it to him. Not very long after that, that friend of his showed him the handkerchief, and it was peeling off strand by strand. Evidently, it was shop-soiled. It had stayed too long in the shop or something. Whatever it is, my father used to say, God knows how to give you something which endures. It may not look so attractive, but he knows how to give you something that is strong and enduring. You know, friends, we don't look very far. We don't walk by faith. We walk by sight. And the Bible tells us that we should walk by faith. Sometimes very often I have chosen places which are very tough, where nobody would want to go. Places where there was imminent danger. But such were the places where we pioneered and built God's work. I praise God for that. You know, the soft places, the easy places, do not help to advance your faith. Here, Joshua was asked by Caleb at 85 years. Imagine a man asking for a mountain inhabited by Anakims, who are known as giants. Huge, powerful people. Give me this mountain. Now, it was somehow not in Caleb and people of that ilk to ask for easy, soft places. Isn't that a tragedy that today there are places around the world which are almost untouched? You know, our poor brother Tony suffered from those tongue twisters. And he could get Arunachal Pradesh. Arunachal Pradesh is quite a mouthful, of course. It borders China and Burma, and it's very difficult terrain. And the international line was accepted years ago, but now it is contested. And so suddenly you can have some forces, you know, invading and just taking a chunk off, which has been done already. But some of those boys who come to our Bible school tell me, I asked one of them recently, does your daddy still go and work in China? He said, yes. He goes into China, he works there, and then comes back after some months or weeks. I don't know how that is possible, but such are the tribes of animists and people where little girls have no chance, no chance. They are married off at time when they're tiny. And their bridegroom set them to work in their fields. And you can imagine what they are used for. And we are set to save such people. Now, my dear friends, it's not a sentimental journey on which we are. You know, emotion and sentiment do not last very long. That is why I never try to whip up emotion and sentiment. If there is not that Christian heart which says, hey, how can I have all these privileges and all this light when another human being just like me is deprived all this light just because he or she is underprivileged or lives in a remote place where nobody appears to care? You know, my dear friend, somehow a Christian heart can never come to terms with injustice and oppression. And let me tell you, there are large regions in the world today where their entire history can be summed up in those two words, oppression and repression. And yet the liberating word of God, what a liberation the word of God gives us. You know, friends, I can look any man in the eye, and it is my habit to speak straight and tell the truth. I don't feel that I'm disadvantaged. I'm not rich. I'm just a very ordinary person. But this is a freedom into which Jesus has brought us. And there is a power back of this freedom. I give you power over all the power of the enemy. And if we are afraid to utilize it, or if we are afraid to possess it, who is at fault? Who is failing? Certainly it's not God. Now, have you ever claimed something tough for Jesus? Or is it just the easy road that you have chosen? You know, modern life is very deceptive. We seem to think the more gadgets we have, the more easy life becomes. Hardly. You know, when you become so conscious and dependent on this gadget and that gadget, you lose the very important faculty of being able to make do. Ever heard that phrase? Make do with so little and yet feel so happy and satisfied. Yes. Whereas an accumulation of things, or even an accumulation of money, what profit is there in that? But look at this man at 85 years. Caleb has not lost his mettle. He has not lost his drive. He has not lost that positive attitude. Through God, I can do it. Through Christ, I am bound to win. He did not lose that attitude. You know, some of these big financiers and the wealthiest people sometimes sneer at Christians and say these are born losers. What's the good of these Christians? These are born losers. Look at my empire. Look at the skyscrapers I have. No, my dear friends, don't you ever believe those words. Don't you ever get intimidated by those sneers. That's not true. I can do all things. I know both how to abound and how to be abased. He writes that in prison, as a prisoner rather, in Rome, awaiting judgment. And of course, his execution. I know both how to be abased and how to abound. I don't think Christians know either. You know, they get so sensitive, they get hurt over little things. That means you don't know how to be abased. How would it be if you were hung up by Interstate 99 for 10 minutes? Oh, you will die before they put you up. With a sense of humiliation. It's amazing that some of these great people who worked among the poor have discovered some great truths. And one of those truths appear to be that without humiliation, you do not really learn humility. See, we bristle. We are free people. You have no business to humiliate me. You have no business to talk like that. I will sue you for defamation or something else. Now, that's our reaction. But what was the reaction of Jesus? He amazed the judges. Don't you hear what these people are witnessing against you? Won't you speak one word in your defense? My dear people, the greatness of our Lord. We don't have it. I know both how to be abased, I know how to abound. You know, I have found that this is a very sad observation. Very often, when people have a little excess money, they hardly know how to use it. With the result, somebody around them suffers. And most often it's their children that suffer when there is excess money. They don't know how to be abased, they don't know how to abound. Now, here is this man at 85 saying, testifying, now God has preserved me and all my faculties, and both to go in and to go out, whatever the need, I can meet it. What an attitude of faith. He is faithful. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Father, let us take a page out of Caleb's life and say, I want this faith. I want this faith which was in the daughter of Caleb. The faith that will not rest with a dry and thirsty land, but will claim the upper and the nether springs. So, Lord, give to us those springs which never run dry. Please, Lord, please, Lord, our need is very great. And faith is at a low ebb around us. We need faith, Lord, we need faith. We need eyes that are fixed upon Jesus. Our eyes wander away upon the stormy wind and the turbulent waves. We need eyes that are fixed on Jesus. We need this faith, good Lord. Faith that will serve us for every situation, which will never leave us dry. So help us that we might really function and execute at an hour like this. We ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
I don't know about tomorrow. I just live.